There is a book called Anatomy of an Illness by Norman Cousins. In this book, the author writes about his life and the sickness that he has faced and how he got healed using laughter as a therapy. Norman, when he was around 49 years old, he went to Russia for a business trip, and when he returned from Russia, he fell severely ill and he was hospitalized. Doctors diagnosed his condition as ankylosing spondylitis. Ankylosing spondylitis. This is a degenerative disease, some sort of severe form of arthritis, causes immense pain in the body. So he was on the bed for many months, and doctor also told that he would not have many years to live, and also 1 in 500 person would get healed of this disease. So Norman believed that he would be the one person, so he worked towards that by gathering knowledge. And he later on realized his health deteriorated was primarily because of the stress and the negative emotions that he faced in his life. So his health was deteriorated primarily because of the negative emotions and the stress that he faced in his life. So he thought to himself, if negative emotions and stress could cause health deterioration, it can be replaced with positive emotions. So he spoke to the doctor saying that he doesn't want to take any medications with respect to the painkillers. He only wanted to have the supplements like vitamin C, which was trying to build his immune system. So he continued with that with little heavier doses. And instead of painkiller, he would laugh. And with that, over the period of time, he got healed completely. Now, he writes in one of the articles, he says like this, 10 minutes of laughter would enable him to sleep without pain for 2 hours. 10 minutes of laughter would enable him to sleep without pain for 2 hours. So, for sure, you know, the scripture fulfills in this person like this. Laughter is a good medicine. Proverbs 17:22 says laughter is a good medicine. Definitely this scripture has been fulfilled in this person's life, which I believe it can fulfill in anyone who believes. Amen. Now why I'm narrating this story is very simple, because just like Norman replaced his negative emotions with positive emotions, we also should learn to replace our negative emotions with positive emotions that comes from the presence of God, or that comes by knowing who our God is. Amen. We should learn to replace our negative emotions with positive emotions by knowing who our God is. Now, in a scenario like where we are, where the times that we are living in, where COVID is rampant across our state, even our nation, so too often we are getting to hear only negative news through media. Now, if you switch on the TV and we want to hear news, definitely it is not comforting and brings a lot of fear and anxiety in our mind, and it eventually affects even our bodies. So, just like Norman did, we also should know our the stress-causing things that are happening in our life, and we should learn to replace those thoughts with the positive thoughts. Now, even in the scripture, Philippians chapter 4 verse 8 says, it goes like this, finally, my brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. If anything is about excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. That means Paul is encouraging us to meditate on good things, good reports, lovely, noble, pure, not on the negative things that can cause damage to our body or to our mind or even our spiritual life. So Paul is asking us to encourage to meditate on good things. Amen. So now, if we meditate on good things, which the thoughts which came from that comes in the from the presence of God, truly it will build our immunity to overcome the attacks of the enemy in our life. Now, in the natural, we are all facing the coronavirus as a threat to our body or to our being. So what do doctors advise us to do? Instead of being worried about coronavirus, why don't you build your immunity by eating vitamin-rich fruits or vegetables? So we end up eating good vitamin-rich vegetables and fruits so that our immunity is strong. Even if you are attacked by coronavirus, so we are, we are not affected by it very badly. Why? Because of a strong immunity that we have, which can withstand the attack of the coronavirus. Similarly, we also should learn to build our spiritual immunity stronger so that we can withstand the attack of the enemy, not only the spiritual enemy like Satan, but also because our mind is governed by the positive thoughts and which comes from in the presence of God, it governs our mind and heart. Over the period of time, it will govern our life, and eventually it will overflow in every area of our life. So we should learn to build our immunity, spiritual immunity stronger. Now, how we can build our spiritual immunity stronger? It is through a simple scripture, like I said, knowing God. Now, when we read a simple scripture like a known scripture like John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. So eternal life is not about the future life, it is about now. Have eternal life. So when we believe in Jesus, we have the opportunity to experience eternal life now. Now, what is eternal life? Now, we have the answer in John chapter 17, verse 3. Bible says like this: this is eternal life, that they may know the Father and the Son. This is eternal life, that they may know the Father and the Son. That means the relationship that we share with the Father and the Son, out of which proceeds is eternal life. That means he is calling us into the participation of life, fellowship with him. Even John says in 1 John, our fellowship is with the Father and the Son. So he's not saying our fellowship was with the Father and Son. He's simply saying our fellowship is with. It is a present continuous tense. Our fellowship is with the Father and the Son. So that is what will allow us to experience eternal life. That and not only that eternal life will flow in us, it will flow through us. Amen. So that is how we can build our spiritual immunity. Now, for the sake of preaching, I want to preach a message on immunity. I want to break this word immunity into two parts: I am and immunity. I am and immunity. Now, when I'm using the word I am, I want to use it as a I am. I-A-M. Now, we all know the word I am correlates to God's name. The word I am is God's name. Now, in Exodus chapter 3 verse 14, when Moses was asking God to reveal, asking God about his name, God revealed his name as I am. Why? It's simply because God can be whatever he can be, because that is what he is. I am who I am. I am what I can be. So it is, if God wants to be Jehovah Jireh, he can be Jehovah Jireh. If God wants to be Jehovah Rapha, he can be Jehovah Rapha. If God wants to be Jehovah Shalom, he can be Jehovah Shalom. If God wants to be Jehovah Shammah, he can be Jehovah Shammah. So whatever God wants he to be, he can be because of who he is. That is why the name I am. So now, everything was created by Jesus, for him and by him and through him. So now, why I'm saying all these things? So when we read John, we get to realize Jesus is using the same word, telling us that I am the one who created the world, and I am the one, and I am the vine, and you are the branches. So now, come with me to John chapter 15, verse 1. I want to use this scripture to explain how eternal life is flowing in us and through us. How eternal life is flowing in us and through us. So now, what did I say? Eternal life is all about knowing the Father and the Son. So both the Father and Son is working together to help us to experience eternal life and to help us bear fruit, and so that our joy will be full. Amen. So that our joy will be full. So now please come with me to John chapter 15 and verse 1 onwards we will read. This scripture I'm using to explain the I am. In that I am, we can see God the Father and God the Son working together to help us to experience the eternal life. Now, John chapter 15 verse 1, I am the true vine and the Father is the wine dresser. I am the true vine and the Father is the wine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that does not bear fruit, he prunes, that it might bear more fruit. Verse 3, already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. And verse 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So now I want to explain this scripture to reveal how the Father and the Son both working together to release eternal life in us. It's a very beautiful scripture, and often sometimes it can be like a scary scripture if we use different lens. But if we read John chapter 13, 14, 15, you know, if you read continuously, Jesus is revealing two persons in his last sermon speech, in the last communication that he's having with his disciples before he's going on the cross. He's revealing two persons. Number one, he's revealing the Father to us. Number two, he's revealing the Holy Spirit to us, so that we should not be troubled that we are left alone on this earth, but we, for sure that we know that we have a Comforter, Holy Spirit is with us. And also Jesus is talking about I and Father will come and dwell with you. I and Father will come and dwell with you. That is what Jesus is revealing, through this chapter 13, 14, 15, and 16. He is revealing those things. And if you read 17, you can understand the climax that is happening through prayer. So now, let's go to this John chapter 15, verse 1. I am the true vine. My father is the wine dresser. So now, we see Jesus as the vine and we are the branches. He is the true vine. We are the branches. That means our life is attached to the source, and his life, if we are the branches, we are attached to him. His life is flowing through us. His life is flowing through us. And Jesus realized this. He is the source and we are the branch. He is the source. We are the branch. Even if you go to Genesis chapter, 1 during the time of creation, whenever God wanted to create something, he speaks to the source. For example, if he wants to create a fish, when God wanted to create fish, he was speaking to the waters and telling the water, bring forth fish. So that is why when you separate the fish from the source of water, the fish dies. Similarly, when he wanted to bring forth the tree, he spoke to the land, bring forth trees. So that is why when you separate the tree from the land, the tree dies. So similarly, when we got separated from God, when we stopped reflecting his image, when we stopped reflecting his likenesses, over the period of time, we not only died, but we also got deteriorated completely, and we corrupted this entire world because of how we handle this earth. So now Jesus is completely, reclaiming our humanity, by dying on the cross for us. Got buried, and then when he rose back from the dead, he made us a new creation. When we believe in Jesus, we are experiencing the power of new creation working in our life. Amen. So, what I want to tell you this morning is, he is the source, and he knows that apart from him, we can do nothing. So we are connected to him, and we are one with him, and his life is flowing in us. And when we see a scripture, the second part of the scripture in the verse 1, my father is the wine dresser. It appears to be he is like a third person watching from outside, and he's standing with a scissor in his hand or knife in his hand, a garden scissor, and if you don't bear any fruit in this union, he's ready to cut us off. That is how the picture often comes when we read the second scripture. Now, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Some scripture talks about he cuts away. So the word takes away, in Greek it is called airo. That means lifts us up. Now, when we read NKJV which has a footnote and all, we can see that takes away in smaller line, they would have written lifts us up. So probably one of the translation could be, because they have no clear clarity, so used whatever could fit into this frame. They used the word takes away or cut off. But this scripture also can be translated as, when we don't bear fruit, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he lifts the branches up and ties on the pole, so that the branch which was not exposed to sun, the branch which was not exposed to breeze, now it will expose to breeze and it will bear fruit over the period of time. Now, Jesus and Father are one, correct? Now, that is what Jesus says in John chapter 14, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Now, when Peter denied Jesus, did Jesus get upset with Peter? No. When Peter rejected Jesus and walked away from Jesus, it was Jesus who went after Peter to bring Peter back into his life. Similarly, when we don't bear fruit, okay, God the Father is not upset with us, but he draws us unto himself, just like Jesus did with Peter, and he begins to help us to bear fruit. So that is why, Jesus says, apart from me, you can do nothing. Abide in me, because I will also abide in you. Abide in me, and I will also abide in you. So that's what Jesus says, abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit by itself, unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. So he knows very clearly, he has done his part to come closer to us through the death, through the burial and the resurrection. Now our part is to trust in him, to believe in him, and then abide in him. Abiding in him is what? Hearing him, knowing him, and doing his will. Amen. And when we love him, obeying him is not a difficult task. And Bible says in verse John chapter 15, verse 5 says, apart from me you can do nothing. That means he will help us to bear fruit. He will help us to obey also. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That means God will definitely help us to obey him. When he gives a command to obey, his grace is sufficient for us to obey. I'm sure that sometimes we all can struggle up and down. We can go through in life, but his grace is sufficient for us. And if you have a sincerity in our heart, and when we try to follow him, his grace is sufficient for us, and he will surely help us. So now that's the first part of immunity, I am. The second part which I want to expound is immunity. Immunity means a privilege that is granted. A privilege that is granted. Now, what kind of privilege that has been granted to us? Number one, his presence. God has given his presence. God has given us his Holy Spirit to dwell in us. No, he has given his Holy Spirit as a comforter, as a helper for our lives. Now, number two, why he is doing that? Why? Because we are his children. Now, Bible also talks about whoever receives Jesus, they become the children of God. Amen? They become the children of God. So now, we have a couple of reasons to have this privilege granted in our life. Because we are the sons of God, we are the sons and daughters of God. And also, we have the presence of God in us. Just because we have the presence of God in us, you and I can have the joy of the Lord in our life. Joy of the Lord in our life. Now, joy of the Lord is not our joy. It is God's joy. What is God's joy? In Hebrews, it talks about, when when Jesus was on the cross, when he was when he was embracing the shame, you know, because of us, he saw ahead of what was ahead of him. Mm-hmm. He saw the joy that was set before him, and he endured the pain because of that. You know, when God saw you and me, he didn't think twice to go on the cross for us. He knew that without him, we are nothing. Without him, nobody can save us. So he endured the cross so that when he was lifted up on the cross, he could draw us to him. Amen. That is what he has done for us on the cross. So when he sees us right now, he sees us as his joy. When he sees you, you bring joy to him. You bring pleasure to him. You are his delight. And that is how God sees us. And that is how we have to see ourselves. That means we have to see ourselves like the way God sees us. Often we see ourselves the way that we want to see our own life. No, that if we see our own life, probably we can experience condemnation and guilt. I'm not saying we should not correct our ways, but I'm saying we should correct our ways in the presence of God. And we should see ourselves in the light of God, how much God loves us. Because when we experience the goodness from God, we repent. We change our ways. We change our thinking. So that is exactly happens to us. So when we experience the goodness of God, his love, his joy, okay? So what happens? There is a change happening in our life. And then the way we see ourselves like that, our vocabulary also changes. Instead of grumbling, we are thankful to God for what he has done. We are thankful to God for what he has given us. We are thankful to God that we are no more orphans. We are thankful to God for the provision that he has provided. We are thankful to God for the protection that he has given us. We are thankful to God, even though we may go through the valley of shadow of death, even though we may go through trials and tribulations, you know, we can be of good cheer. Why? Because he has gone ahead of us. He knows the way. He will bring us safely to our destiny. So that's how we can trust the Lord and be grateful even in the most difficult situation. By doing that, we can exercise the joy of the Lord in our life, which is our strength. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Amen. And finally, I want to close this with a small scripture. Philippians chapter 2 verse 12 that talks about work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, Paul is not talking about work towards your salvation. He's not talking about work towards salvation. Salvation is a free gift. God has given us. Now, when Paul is talking about what he's talking about, work out your salvation, the word fear is often related, associated with the presence of God in our life. In the Old Testament, the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of God is the presence of God. You know, that's how the fear has been associated with. So Paul is saying, since God has given you a new life, since you have been forgiven, since God has given you a new life, you know, use this new life and live out this new life, knowing that God is in your midst. Knowing that God is in your midst. That is how Paul is asking us to encourage us to work out our salvation, being God being in our mind, God being in our present, God being in our midst. So with the knowledge of God, with the consciousness of God being with us, that's how Paul wants us to live this new life. Amen. So now, in reality, there is no word called, we cannot break this word immunity, but for the sake of preaching, I broke this word just to help us realize if we have this immunity that I am, when we know that I am is with us, because God is giving us the eternal life, we can have the presence of God and the joy of the Lord, and we can work out this salvation knowing that, you know, God is in our midst. So we exercise this new life, acknowledging God is in the midst and he will take care of us and he will lead us and guide us. Amen. So that is how we can replace these negative thoughts with the positive thoughts. And I believe by doing this, we can see God working in us and through us. Amen. So God bless you all. Have a wonderful week ahead. Amen.